where we're coming to you with breaking news from the Washington Post that may call into question Rod Rosenstein's role in overseeing the Mueller investigation. This new report details attempts by Rosenstein to keep his job in the wake of a news account that suggested he was willing to wear a wire to secretly record Donald Trump. Based on this investigation, Rosenstein telling the president he would make sure Trump was treated fairly by Mueller. Quote, this is Rosenstein now. I give the investigation credibility, Rosenstein said, in the words of one administration official offering their own characterization of the call. Quote, I can land the plane. These comments were made in September of 2018, a full 6 months before Robert Mueller would tell the Justice Department that he was finished with his probe. For six more months, under Rosenstein's supervision, Mueller would continue interviewing witnesses and bringing cases. This took place 6 months before Mueller determined that he could not exonerate Trump on the question of obstruction of justice. 6 months before Bill Barr would decide to let Trump off the hook anyway. And that is where we start today with some of our favorite reporters and friends. Ashley Parker, White House reporter for The Washington Post, who just broke this story minutes before we sat down here. Former U.S. attorney and MSNBC contributor Joyce Vance joins us. And NBC and MSNBC national affairs analyst John Heilman. Joyce is not with us yet. We're going to start with you, Ashley. I'm going to read a little bit more of your colleague's report, which crossed our wires. Do they still have wires? Crossed our wires a few minutes ago. Rod Rosenstein was in danger of losing his job. The New York Times had just reported that in the heated days after James Comey was fired as FBI director, the deputy attorney general had suggested wearing a wire to surreptitiously record President Trump. Now Trump, traveling in New York, was on the phone, eager for an explanation. Rosenstein, who by one account had gotten teary-eyed just before the call in a meeting with Trump's chief of staff, sought to defuse the volatile situation and assure the president he was on his team. That's according to people familiar with the matter. He criticized the Times report published in late September and blamed it on former deputy FBI director Andrew McCabe. Then he talked about special counsel Robert Mueller's investigation of Russia's interference in the 2016 election and told the president he would make sure Trump was treated fairly. I give the investigation credibility, Rosenstein said. Quote, I can land the plane. Ashley Parker, it is a stunning piece of reporting from your colleagues, and it is a stunning piece of timing. It was just last night at an event that Rod Rosenstein took the rather extraordinary step of accusing everyone from the Obama Justice Department to the media to cable news pundits of their trespasses and really holding himself out as a one-man rule of law beacon. This story calls his role in the Mueller probe into question.
Well, the story is a great deep dive, and what it really does is it goes behind the scenes and sort of chronicles all of his moves and his roles and what he said throughout this whole process. And one thing it takes you in to see is the way that people who work for the president, work for that administration, often found themselves scrambling to fight for their jobs, to try not to get fired by a tweet, and to sort of balance these two often competing directives. One is which is carrying out their own job, what they were directed to do, and the other is pleasing that most important audience of one. And if you read this piece, one thing you see is that in his own way, Rosenstein is doing a bit of what the president does. The president is someone who can go in a room and say something, and people often hear what they want to hear. That's why you can have Dreamers, for instance, think he's supporting them, and then hardline immigration people think he's supporting them. And you sort of see Rosenstein navigating that line with the president, where the president seems to think that Rosenstein is saying, I will treat you fairly, and seems to believe it is protection, but there is a little bit of giving himself plausible deniability that he's being fair by simply carrying out his job. And the devil, of course, as always, is in the details.
Let me read a little bit more of the account for you. On multiple occasions, according to people familiar with the matter, Rosenstein told Trump he was not a target of Mueller's investigation, using law enforcement jargon that can refer to people about whom the Justice Department has gathered substantial evidence of criminal wrongdoing. Mueller's report makes clear that investigators focused on Trump. His attorneys were informed informed he was a subject, a different bureaucratic term, meaning his conduct was being investigated. And Mueller's report details conduct that legal observers have said could constitute obstruction of justice. This does seem like what you're describing there, Ashley, that he was managing the president using the word subject, which I understand was always used because of the memo and special counsel Mueller's commitment to not indicting the president. So if they had treated him or classified him as a target, it would have been irrelevant in this case because they didn't plan on indicting him. But it goes to the theme, mollifying the president. Is there a suggestion in this account that, you know, landing the plane is something that the president's close ally, Chris Christie, said Matt Whitaker was brought in to do when it came to the Mueller probe? Landing the plane is what we know. We know Donald Trump wanted done with the Mueller probe. The timing of this reporting is such a stunner. This took place in September. Robert Mueller didn't walk into the Attorney General's office until March of 2019 to say that he was finished.
Yeah, there's a lot to unpack there, but just going briefly to the first point, what you read is, again, that is a bit of sleight of hand, a bit of linguistic jujitsu, target versus subject. And so you have a president who is able to hear in that exactly what he wants to hear. As you said, he wants someone to land the plane, and he can believe that Rosenstein is doing that sort of in a way that the president believes is landing it in a way that protects him, where, again, he may just mean, and it's unclear which side meant what, or maybe Trump hears what he wants to hear, that he is simply landing it by, in his eyes, performing the duties of his job fairly and efficiently and reasonably, and that is what has allowed him to survive this far.
Joyce Vance joins us now. Joyce, let me read to you a piece of this remarkable piece of reporting from Ashley and her colleagues, Ashley's colleagues at The Washington Post. The headline is, "I Can Land the Plane, How Rosenstein Tried to Mollify Trump, Protect Mueller, and Save His Job." Rosenstein had gotten teary-eyed just before a call with the president in a meeting with Trump's chief of staff, sought to defuse the volatile situation and ensure the president he was on his team. That's according to people familiar with the matter. He criticized the Times report. That was the one that reported that Rod Rosenstein was willing to wear a wire and talked about wrangling votes for the 25th Amendment that published in the New York Times in late September, and blamed it on former FBI Director Andrew McCabe, whose recollections formed its basis. Then he talked about Special Counsel Robert Mueller's investigation of Russia's interference in the 2016 election and told the president he would make sure Trump was treated fairly. Quote, "I give the investigation credibility," Rosenstein said. "I can land the plane." Joyce, the Post not alleging that Rosenstein did anything unseemly or untoward, but this reporting taken with what we know Rod Rosenstein's role was with Attorney General Barr in making that declination decision on obstruction of justice, something Robert Mueller did not do, and a very angry speech from Deputy Attorney General Rod Rosenstein at an event last night definitely paints a different picture than the one we have seen prior to those three occurrences.
You know, it is very difficult to know what to make of those two events happening so closely together, this new reporting and last night's speech. And in the speech last night, Rosenstein hammered some rule of law themes. He talked about how important it was to understand that government existed to serve people and that everyone was entitled to the protection of the rule of law. So there's a possible read on this story that says that Rosenstein was just trying to let Mueller finish doing his work. And of course, there's a darker possibility here that Mueller actually did something that no prosecutor should do, saying that he was on the team of a target or a subject of an investigation. So it's troubling. We'll need to look further into this to see exactly where it lands.
Joyce, I listened to that speech last night and thought it was stunning that of all the men and women on planet Earth, that a sitting deputy attorney general who has just made the decision that Robert Mueller, after 22 months, wouldn't and couldn't make to exonerate Donald Trump on the question of obstruction, quoted Donald Trump on the rule of law in that speech last night. That was not Rod Rosenstein as a neutral arbiter finding, you know, someone that everyone can agree on is some sort of beacon for the rule of law when he quoted Donald Trump.
You know, that was my initial reaction too, Nicole, and I talked to half a dozen people who were in the room last night, and they told me it came across a little bit differently as they listened to it yesterday. So I went back and I reread it, and I suppose that there's a possibility, giving the speech a very generous reading, that Rosenstein, instead of vouching for the president, was simply, in some ways, almost holding the president's own words up to the president. But I think that would be generous at best. And this notion that Donald Trump stands in any way for the rule of law is abhorrent after we've seen him trash the rule of law virtually every day of this presidency.
John Heilman, the folks that know people like Rod Rosenstein and Bill Barr best maintain that there's something in them, in their DNA, that is loyal or faithful to the institutions. But as an outsider, it doesn't come across. You know, you see Bill Barr talk about spying occurring, and you see Donald Trump literally as an echo chamber of Bill Barr's testimony in a news on Sean Hannity's, an interview on Hannity last night. You hear Rod Rosenstein quote someone who, under no objective analysis, stands for anything close to the rule of law. It was 8 days ago that the report came out where Robert Mueller wrote, "If I could clear him of crimes, I would." That came out 8 days ago. Rod Rosenstein last night, I read it very differently. He could have quoted anyone from the beginning of time, from Roman times. He could have quoted anyone on the rule of law, quoting Trump. This stunning reporting from the Washington Post of Rod Rosenstein, in so many of these people, so many of these actions take place when they're crying. He's crying again. There's a third news account of Rod Rosenstein crying. I love a man that can cry. John Boehner, one of my favorite criers. George Bush cried all the time. But the idea that he said, "I can land the plane, I'm on your team," as an outsider, that doesn't look remotely objective.
No. One of the things in this whole story of Donald Trump and the Mueller investigation, Rod Rosenstein has been one of the most interesting characters and one of the most difficult to get a bead on, because he's been a hero of the left, a hero of the right. He's behaved in inconsistent ways. In the middle of that story has been a mystery. The mystery has been, how did he survive that New York Times story? The story that said he talked about wearing a wire and he talked about rustling up votes to invoke the 25th Amendment. How did he survive? This reporting in the Washington Post, if it is to be believed, and it seems highly credible, is we now have an answer. He survived by kissing Donald Trump's ass. And you read this reporting, you know, you have this quote from a senior administration official Trump ended the call with Rosenstein, thinking that he was on the team after all. So Trump, who doesn't have a great grasp of subtlety and nuance, something was said to Trump that made him think that Rod Rosenstein was on the team after all. So one maybe can conclude from that and the other reporting in the story that Rosenstein went pretty far to doing that. That is a ridiculous thing to do. There is no, it's an unethical thing to do. It's an immoral thing to do. I don't care whether he was trying to allegedly protect the Mueller investigation. Maybe he was, maybe he wasn't. Maybe he was making himself more central to this thing than need be. At some point, Matthew Miller has said many times on this show and elsewhere that Rosenstein's fundamental weakness is his weakness. And he apparently was willing to do things that were wildly inappropriate for someone who was overseeing this investigation, for someone who on this matter was the highest ranking law enforcement official in the land, because Jeff Sessions was at the time recused. I'll also say this. You just read through the rest of the story to get to your point about the rule of law speech. What does it say here? It says that on multiple occasions, Rosenstein reassured Trump that he was not a target. He talked about how he agreed with Trump overall that he was being treated unfairly. Mm-hmm. Unfairly in what sense, we don't know, but perhaps by the media. Later, we now have him standing behind Barr, defending Barr on the ways in which Barr wildly mangled Mueller's, what was in the actual Mueller report, mm-hmm. the ways in which Barr acted as a political character. Rosenstein signed on to that. He stood behind him in that press conference. And now you have him not only citing Trump as a paragon of the rule of law, but he's criticizing the Obama administration for not publicizing the full story about Russian hacking and social media influence operations. and launching blistering attacks on the media. He sounds like a now, in a weird way, like Bill Barr. All of a sudden, Rod Rosenstein started to sound like a full-blown Trumpkin, like a Trump acolyte, especially in this moment right now in the wake of all this criticism. I think, you know, we are going to, many of the mysteries about Rod Rosenstein are now becoming less mysterious, and they are not painting a pretty picture.
All right, we have been joined since this story broke. We brought in everybody that you'd want to hear from with a story like this. MSNBC Justice and Security Analyst Matt Miller is here, as well as Jeremy Bash. Matt, let me start with you. I wanted to, and there's Matt Zapatosky, the reporter. Wait. Let me go to the reporter who wrote the story. Bring him back. There you are. First of all, congratulations on the scoop. I want to go back in time with you because you're writing about a moment that's almost 6 months ago. And before we get lost in that bizarre, at least optically bizarre dynamic of what happened last night, Rod Rosenstein quoting Donald Trump on the rule of law 8 days after Robert Mueller said it's not clear that we can't say he didn't commit crimes. I want to go back in time to this period. I remember this week. I remember talking to sources close to Rosenstein and sources close to the White House that Monday, which was the first work day after the New York Times had reported that Rosenstein had been willing to wear a wire and was talking about the 25th Amendment with other cabinet secretaries. The Justice Department, Public Affairs, and Ledge Affairs offices worked overtime Friday to push back against that story. The story they put out, some of them, was that he was being sarcastic. They didn't deny that those words had come out of his mouth. They worked over the weekend, and Rosenstein, Matt, you take me in, I'm sure you're reporting's better than mine was. But Monday came around and Rosenstein was ready to resign. And I think this is the third news account of Rosenstein crying. And I don't say that to mock or humiliate him, but just as a window into his state of mind during these episodes. And then what you're reporting today, that he got on the phone with the president. President was in New York. He went over and met with Kelly. And what happened next?
So he goes over and meets with Kelly, and his job is kind of in the offing here, right? The New York Times has just reported this explosive story. You mentioned the impact it had publicly. Of course, it had that times 10 on Rosenstein. So he goes over to the White House, and Kelly is sort of saying, what's going on? Explain this story to us. Did you want to surreptitiously record the president? What's happening here? Rosenstein won't get into any details. He's very emotional. One person very familiar with what is happening says that he has tears in his eyes. Rosenstein today, a person familiar with his account, disputes that. But anyway, that meeting sort of wraps up. Rosenstein goes off to another meeting at the White House, and then he has this call with Trump. And again, his job is kind of in the balance here, at least from his perspective. He feels like he might be getting forced out of being the deputy attorney general. But he talks to Trump, and he kind of convinces the president that he's on his side. Now, we don't know, I think, as the panel has pointed out, if he said anything that would sort of objectively be viewed as inappropriate. We don't know if he said, don't worry, I'm going to make sure you're not charged or something like that. Certainly his statement to us today would kind of dispute that he says anything like that. But he does assure the president that Mueller is going to be fair to him and he's going to make sure of that and that he's on the president's team. This kind of in conjunction with the relationship he's developed with the president and the president's aides, sending nice notes to White House staffers when it's their birthday or they've been quoted in the media or on TV, showing up at a lot of White House events. He's really worked to make nice with the White House, and he sort of uses all that capital in this call with the president and talks about Mueller's investigation. And at the end of the day, he's saved. It does take some time. He doesn't leave this call with the president thinking, I am in the clear. In fact, sort of that whole weekend, it's like, will he be forced out? Mm-hmm. Won't he be forced out? I think everyone remembers there was supposed to be like a high stakes meeting with the president, though I'm sure everyone also remembers it just kept getting put off because Rosenstein really had kind of saved himself.
And let's go back in time as well and remind people what Rosenstein was subjected to daily. In the primetime hours on Fox News, there was nightly coverage of the effort from Jim Jordan and Mark Meadows and others. There were articles of impeachment drafted for Rod Rosenstein by the then Republican-led, Devin Nunes-led House Intel Committee. And there was a real prospect. The DAG's office, which had taken over oversight of the Mueller probe after Sessions recused, worked all day, every day, to hold at bay the president's Republican allies in the House Intel Committee, who had declassified the Carter Page FISA application, who had drafted articles of impeachment for Rod Rosenstein. So when this Times story about Rosenstein's willingness to wear a wire and his emotional state after the firing of Comey and the use of his five-page memos, the justification for having done so, when that reporting came out, Rosenstein was already had his back up against the wall from the president's allies. The reporting, though, that he told the president he would land the plane and that he was on his team. Is it your sense that Robert Mueller knew that's what the person overseeing his probe had assured someone who was at least a subject of the obstruction investigation at that point and possibly the conspiracy investigation?
I'm not sure what Robert Mueller knows about any of this. I don't know that Rosenstein, aside from what we can read in the Mueller report about what Rosenstein told Robert Mueller about the firing of Jim Comey, which is a separate issue, I don't know that we know what Rosenstein told Mueller, if anything, about his much later interactions with the president. This was like September of 2018, long after the firing of Comey, which is described in Mueller's report. And I also don't know how interesting it would be to Mueller, not to pull a Mueller here, but I'm not trying to make a conclusion one way or the other about what Rosenstein said to the president was inappropriate. We're just sort of reporting what he said, but it is very interesting that he's talking with the president, at least in broad terms, about the Mueller probe, because like you say, the president was a subject. Mueller, even though Rosenstein is sort of going over there and using this kind of legal jargon, don't worry, you're not a target, you're not a target. Mueller's team had told the president's lawyers, that he was a subject. And you can see from Mueller's report, who cares about what word we use? Mueller was investigating the president of the United States personally, and he had a lot of evidence about all these obstructive episodes. So clearly, Rosenstein is trying to kind of calm the president by getting him attached to this kind of bureaucratic jargon that doesn't actually, at the end of the day, mean much. I think his defenders would say that was so Trump would lay off the probe, but, you know, maybe his detractors would say, well, he knew the way this was going to go, and maybe it was rigged in some way.
Jeremy Bash joins us by phone, and that's the question I have for you, Jeremy. If you take Matt's excellent reporting and you mash it up against the result, the word he just used, rigged, you can't help but ask the question, and we're not making that allegation, nobody is, but it certainly calls into question, if Rod Rosenstein assured the president at the end of September 2018 that he is the man over the one man overseeing the Mueller probe, his office was the one office at Maine DOJ through which any information about Robert Mueller's investigation flowed, and that went on until days or weeks before Robert Mueller finished interviewing witnesses and came to his conclusion on a conspiracy, that there were no charges to be brought, and on obstruction, that despite the 10 incidents of obstructive behavior, he could neither exonerate nor recommend criminal charges for the president. Rod Rosenstein, 6 months before that, told the president he would land the plane and he was on his team and he wasn't a target. Your thoughts?
Well, Nicole, this cries out, if anything ever could, for a congressional investigation. It requires Rod Rosenstein to come to Capitol Hill and to testify. It certainly requires the Attorney General to testify as well. I think the conduct of the Justice Department, its leadership in receiving the Mueller report, in shaping the way the public viewed it, in writing that four-page quote-unquote summary, in having that press conference when the Mueller report was being distributed, and the role of the Attorney General and the Deputy Attorney General. I think all of that is necessary for the public to understand, for Congress to investigate. I think there likely will be Inspector General investigations, and I think this will be an important lasting legacy. I don't think people should lose sight of the biggest picture here, which is the reason why a Rod Rosenstein is put in this pinched position between the target of an investigation or the subject of an investigation and the investigator is because the president of the United States, as Mueller said in volume two, a little bit inartfully, didn't not commit obstruction of justice, meaning he did. And so it's really the president's conduct that I think needs to be the continued focus of congressional oversight, but Rod Rosenstein's role certainly merits scrutiny.
And Jeremy, just to follow up with you, I mean, I was reminded that Rosenstein is a witness in many of the flashpoints that you're talking about in obstruction. He's a witness in the conversations around the Comey firing. It was his memo, and Robert Mueller writes about it extensively in volume two, as you just referenced. He now also took on the role. He and his office oversaw and was likely aware of the goings-ons more than anybody else. And then at a moment when he thought he would lose his job, he went over there and offered the president a window into his own status, telling him he wasn't a target. If you mash that role as a witness with also a role as an instigator, Rod Rosenstein named Mueller as a special counsel. Are there questions about whether he had prejudged the outcome as a witness in that actual investigation?
Well, I don't know if it means he prejudged the outcome, but I think the fact that he was a witness means he couldn't also be a lawyer in the case. I mean, that's the kind of a core tenet of legal ethics, professional ethics, which is a lawyer can't be a witness in the same case. And so I think probably, Nicole, your point is taken that Rod Rosenstein should have stepped aside, should have recused himself from the beginning once he was used as a justification for the firing of Comey.
Matt Miller joins us. Matt, we've had a lot of conversations about the curious twists and turns of Rod Rosenstein's, I believe he's multiple tours of duty at the U.S. Justice Department. I'm guessing this one was surreal even for him. But this reporting in the Washington Post that describes a conversation that he had with the president when, as I said before, his back was against the wall, thought he would be fired. If you take that again and hold it up with the way it ended, with Rosenstein and Barr being the two men who decided after Robert Mueller wouldn't or couldn't that the obstruction case didn't amount to criminal conduct, it certainly makes this reporting from Matt and his colleagues all the more intriguing.
It is a deeply disturbing report because what it shows is unethical conduct by the Deputy Attorney General. Even without the way the investigation ended, just having this conversation with the president himself and itself and giving the president this assurance is an unethical thing for the deputy to do. In any case, he shouldn't be talking to the president about an investigation into the president under any circumstances. And he shouldn't be giving him assurances about how that investigation will end. And he especially shouldn't be doing it at a time where he's begging and pleading for his own job. And I think this goes to, this question that Heilman referenced earlier about people trying to understand Rod Rosenstein for several years. And I think most people have gotten it wrong. And the way to understand Rod is that he's weak. And he's always been weak. He was weak at the beginning of this investigation when he signed off on the Comey firing and gave the president the excuse, despite we now know, having read the Mueller report, that he knew why the president was firing Comey, that it was over the Russia investigation. He was weak when the president pressured him to open a counter investigation into the investigation, into how it started, to ask the Inspector General to do it. He did that despite there being no predicate, despite knowing it was the president trying to undermine the investigation. And then he was weak when he signed on to Bill Barr's, dishonest, misleading press conference and dishonest, misleading letter about the end of the investigation. He didn't have to do any of those things. And when you take the fact that he gave this assurance to the president, and then he did land the plane in a way that was acceptable to the president, despite the underlying facts being, being almost in some cases the opposite of how he and the Attorney General portrayed them, I think it raises real questions about the way the Deputy Attorney General has performed his job.
So, Matt Miller, let me ask you a question my 7-year-old asks me every day. What happens next? Are you with Jeremy Bash that this calls out for congressional hearings?
It absolutely does. Look, he's only going to be there for the next month, but that's plenty of time for him to go up and explain himself to Congress. And this shouldn't be one of those cases where he goes up and says, I'm not going to talk about conversations with the president. He talked about the conversations with the president in this story. He tried to explain them. He needs to explain those under oath to Congress and explain, did he really give the president this assurance? What is it he said? Look, when you say, I'm going to land the plane, that is a reassuring comment. The president can only take that one way. He means I'm going to land the plane in a way that's acceptable to you, not that I'm going to land it in some way that you're going to be unhappy with. And so he needs to explain exactly what he said. And then he needs to explain why he signed off on the end of the investigation the way he did. The thing that you asked a minute ago, if this raises questions that he prejudged the investigation, of course he did. And I think we've known that for a while. There has never been any way that in 48 hours they got this deep, complicated report. They waited. They judged all of the different legal arguments. They judged the facts. They didn't do what an attorney general, a deputy attorney general would usually do, which is sit down with the prosecutor and have a back and forth about why they came to that judgment. But in 48 hours, they somehow digested that entire thing and wrote a letter that cleared the president. That they absolutely, there is no other conclusion that he and the attorney general absolutely prejudged it. And the question is, did he prejudge it because he had given the president an assurance that he would?
There are a lot of things we've discussed here that are super important, and I agree with Matt Miller about questions that should be posed to Rod Rosenstein by congressional investigators. But there are other questions I think that should come up as well. And these things are now driving to some larger questions. Mm-hmm. We have puzzled over, we've still yet to hear from Bob Mueller.
Right.
We've not had an explanation from Bob Mueller about why his investigations were circumscribed in some respects in the ways they were, about why he felt that he had to end up where he ended up on obstruction of justice.
And not interview the president.
About why he backed off from interviewing the president. In the end, the one thing we know is that Bob Mueller's boss through the entirety of the investigation was Rod Rosenstein. And so now the questions of in what ways, beyond what Rod Rosenstein was saying to Donald Trump, what was Rod Rosenstein saying to Bob Mueller? What ways was Rosenstein, not only was he not, as he tried to portray himself, safeguarding the Mueller investigation, or there are many questions to be asked. I'm not prejudging the outcome, but we now really urgently need to know what was the interaction between Rosenstein and Mueller. And given some of the hints that we're now getting, some of these suggestions, some of the implications that we're drawing out of this,
yeah,
it is really disturbing and beyond a source of concern. I think I have a sense of creeping darkness about,
yeah,
what we would learn if we understood the nature of the relationship between Rosenstein and Mueller. And I don't mean the personal relationship. I mean the ways in which Rosenstein may have been working subtly but in clear ways to not, he could prejudge the outcome because he knew what limits he had placed on the conduct of the investigation and the parameters in which it was drawn. This is a thing that I think gets to the very heart of what the Mueller report ended up being. A lot of the answers are going to lie in Rod Rosenstein, and so I think getting him up in front of Congress is urgent on many levels, but maybe that one most importantly of all.
Jeremy, let me ask you to just unpack. This gets a little complicated and probably dicey for someone like me, a non-lawyer, but let me see if I can put this all out there. We know that one of the mysteries of the end of the Mueller investigation was that we never figured out why he didn't interview the president, that you really couldn't answer intent around obstruction without interviewing the president. We now know that Rod Rosenstein told the president he wasn't a target. He was never going to be indicted. He wasn't a target of that. Why not let Robert Mueller or greenlight any effort to have Robert Mueller interview the president? Or does that render the whole thing moot and pointless and rigged? A question that Matt Zapatosky asked, came up in the reporting.
No, I think you're right, Nicole. I think if you read the written responses that the president wrote on the conspiracy issues, they were a joke. Basically, he said, "I don't recall," over and over and over, and he provided no responses on the obstruction matters. And if you recall, obviously, in our most recent example in history of independent counsel activities, not only did independent counsel Ken Starr interview Bill Clinton, then President Bill Clinton, he actually drew blood. And I don't mean that metaphorically. I mean, literally, the guy rolled up his sleeve, they injected him with a needle, and they drew blood from his arm. And our president wouldn't even answer the questions of the special counsel. It was a complete stonewall, and I think the message was that if you dodge the special counsel, you can get away with a lot. And it's a terrible message to send to criminal defendants all across the country.
Matt, I want to give you the last word because it's your great scoop. And I just want to underscore, you do not report that this was rigged. It's a question that you rightfully say in your analysis is going to come up when people read about Rosenstein's comments. But you've also written about and reported on the sort of ongoing saga during much of the Mueller report about that presidential interview. Does this, in your mind, offer any new information or any new window into the thinking of the man at DOJ who oversaw the Mueller probe about why that landed where it did with no interview for the special counsel with the president and written answers that are very much, as Jeremy Bash says, a whole lot of, I don't know, I don't remember?
I think that's the critical question, right? Rosenstein would have played just an instrumental role in deciding whether the department would authorize a subpoena of the president. That's a close kind of legal question that I don't think Mueller could decide on himself. And if Mueller had decided, he would have put Rosenstein in the position of potentially having to veto him. So, mm-hmm. you know, one of the other panelists raised this great question. What we want to know is what were Rosenstein and Mueller's interactions throughout this whole process? Rosenstein, and still very until very recently, supervised the whole thing. So that to me is a critical question. Unfortunately, I can't shed any light on that with today's reporting, but it's another target.
Rome wasn't built in a day, Matt.
Hey there, I'm Chris Hayes from MSNBC. Thanks for watching MSNBC on YouTube. If you want to keep up to date with the videos we're putting out, you can click subscribe just below me or click over on this list to see lots of other great videos.